welcome to Liturgical Chapel. We are so excited to worship with you this morning. If you are willing and able, would you stand with us as we get to worship together?
Go ahead and take a seat. Well, hey, welcome to this, our second liturgical chapel of the semester. It's a chance in our chapels to kind of engage in practices historical and around the world from traditions that are more liturgical in nature. And maybe I just kind of want to name this. So we are in a liturgical church season known as ordinary time. You may have heard of Advent or Lent. You probably heard of this thing called Christmas. It's coming soon. Whoa. But we're in the season right now of ordinary time. And actually, you see these colors here on the table and on the cross. This color green is the color of ordinary time, and it symbolizes growth. It symbolizes new life and new possibilities. And here we are on the last Friday of October, and I'm guessing that growth and new life, for some of us, feel kind of far away. Feel like they would be nice, but is that what I'm really experiencing? And what I want to invite us to is to be open to the possibility that yes, today, no matter what you might be going through, yes, today, new life, salvation, redemption is still possible, even on a Friday, if you can believe it. Can I invite you to bow your heads as I kind of lead us in a liturgical prayer called a collect prayer. And then in a moment, Lauren will come and read our first scripture for us today. Let's hear these words of this prayer together. Almighty and everlasting God, increase in us the gifts of faith, of hope, of loving kindness, and that we may obtain what you promise. Help us to love what you say is good. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Let's listen to this reading.
This is a reading from Psalm 32. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and is whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. The word of the Lord.
As we continue to worship, you can go ahead and stand if you would like. If you would rather sit and worship, that's okay too. There's an open space for that.
I'm caught up in your presence. Oh, I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. And I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment, and I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. And I just want you. There's nothing else. There's nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you. There's nothing else. There's nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else. There's nothing else, Jesus. Nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else. There's nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else. Oh, there's nothing else, Jesus. Nothing else will do. I just want you. And nothing else. There's nothing else, Jesus. Nothing else. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Oh, Jesus, you don't owe me anything. It's more than anything that just want you. We just want you. There's nothing else. And nothing else. Nothing else will do. We just want you. And nothing else. And nothing else, Jesus, nothing else will do. I just want you.
This is a reading from the Gospel according to Luke. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once, and he welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." The word of the Lord.
All right. Well, thanks, y'all. Go ahead and have a seat again. Thank you, readers, and thank you, band, for leading us in that time. So a few years ago, I attended a business meeting for the denomination that I'm a part of. Now, you can already tell this is going to be a really exciting message, right? Wow, a denominational business meeting. That's wild, Jason. Like, I'm exactly as exciting as you think I am probably right now that I would go to those, and I do. But hang with me. I promise this will have some sort of point probably. So if you can believe it, this business meeting actually took place right here in UTCC. I was sitting right over there, I don't know, like kind of second, third row, so if, I didn't put anything under the chair, it's not like, anyway, but that's where I was. And I would love to tell you that I was being a really good member of my denomination, engaged with the material, really taking it in, but alas, like none of you in your classes, I was not paying attention very much in that meeting. But I do have an excuse. About 2 or 3 hours, yes, you heard me, hours into this meeting, I noticed my back was starting to feel really sore. Like, I just needed to walk around. Have you ever experienced that before? So, I don't know, my body was also bored, I guess, of the meeting. So I got up and watched the rest of the meeting from the back of the room. No big deal, except it didn't end up being a one-time thing. I got this weird pain kind of over and over again the next week, and so I went to the doctor, and they told me, "You have this thing called sciatica." Anybody had sciatica before? It's your sciatic nerve seems to be inflamed. The sciatic nerve kind of runs from your lower back all the way down both of your legs. Here's some medicine. Do some stretches. It will improve soon. Great. Now I can resume my wild itinerary of congregational and denominational business meetings. Back to that story in a minute. But first, this morning we heard two scripture readings, one from the Old Testament book of the Psalms, the other from the Gospel according to Luke in the New Testament. If you were here for our last liturgical chapel a few weeks ago, you may remember that we take these readings from something called the Revised Common Lectionary. A lectionary is just a collection of scripture readings that journeys through the Bible, or the majority of the Bible, in a 3-year cycle. Lectionaries are used in many traditions in the Christian faith that are more liturgical in nature. Each week there's a psalm, an Old Testament, a gospel, and a New Testament reading. And today, that's where these readings came from for this Sunday's lectionary, Psalm 32 and Luke 19. If you go to a church that reads them this week, lectionary, there you go. This morning, we're going to focus a little bit more on this story from Luke. So here it is again, Luke chapter 19, verse 1. It says, "Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through." Pause. So Jesus is at the end of his ministry, like literally, later this chapter, he will be journeying to Jerusalem. He'll ride into the city on a donkey. People will shout, "Hosanna!" Days later, he will be crucified. Like, all of that is right around the corner from this story. But today, Jesus is passing through the city of Jericho. Verse 2, "A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd." So Zacchaeus is an interesting character. He's wealthy, he's attained a certain level of status, but as a Jewish tax collector, you may have learned this in classes or even in chapel, he is seen by his community as a traitor. He's turned his back on his own people. Tax collectors were known for extorting and exploiting people, for taking more tax money than they were supposed to and pocketing the difference. Somehow, this tax collector hears something about this traveling miracle worker called Jesus, and he wants to see what Jesus is all about. But there's a problem. A crowd gathers, and he can't see over the crowd, and yes, it says it's because he's short, but think about this for a moment. Like, if I'm with my family, and we're watching, I don't know, a parade or a concert or something, And imagine, you know, my kids are there and I tell my kids, oh, sorry, you can't see over the crowd because you're short. Bummer for you. Like, no, they're part of my family. I care about them. I would find a way to help them have a better experience. I promise I would do that. What kind of parent is this guy? For Zacchaeus, this seemingly minor moment of not being able to see over the crowd, yes, he's short, but it's kind of a big deal. It signifies his alienation from his own. He's an exploiter of his neighbors, and that same community has no problem being a barrier for him to experience this teacher. These people he's taken advantage of are not about to let him see what's going on, and can you blame them? Why would they? For whatever reason, though, this guy, Zacchaeus, is determined. Verse 4, he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he, meaning Jesus, has gone to be the guest of a sinner, meaning Zacchaeus. I don't know if you have had sciatica before, but it is bad news. Like, avoid it if you can. That's my advice for you today. A week passed, a month passed, 2 months passed. Not only was it not getting better, but it felt like it was getting worse. Like, something didn't seem right. I kept going back to the doctor and would say, you know, are you sure this is supposed to be how it is? Like, should I get some kind of testing done, an x-ray, an MRI, something like that? And they would tell me, hey, sciatica can be rough. Keep doing the stretches, rest, pain medication, it'll be better in no time. Well, it wasn't better in no time. 10 weeks later, after that fateful denominational business meeting, the doctors finally agreed to give me an MRI. Got the MRI done, and it was, we'll call it good news slash mostly bad news. So apparently the most common cause for sciatica is an inflamed sciatic nerve, lower back injury, compression of bones, that type of thing. And as the doctors had told me, usually with some stretching, some rest, medication, sciatica clears up eventually, just kind of goes away. The good news was my back looked perfectly fine. Hooray. The not so good news was that there was a different problem. The MRI showed that while my back was not injured, instead I had a tumor about that big-ish. I don't know, maybe that big. No, I'm just kidding. It was about that big. Growing inside my pelvis and pressing on the sciatic nerve and other things too. Turns out a tumor pressing on your sciatic nerve is not good for you and is quite painful. I promise, don't try it. It's very painful. I've talked a little bit about my cancer journey in chapels here and there. It's a long story of medical tests and pain and treatments. I now live with a disability from the lasting effects of the cancer and medication, use a brace and a cane to get around and all of that. So a story for another time. But for the purposes of this morning, I kind of want to just make this simple observation. It turns out that usually, in the practice of medicine, an effective treatment requires an accurate diagnosis. Let's hear that again. In the practice of medicine, at least, an effective treatment requires an accurate diagnosis. So yes, stretching and some medicine and rest work great for sciatica, unless the sciatica is caused by a cancerous tumor, because suddenly the symptoms of sciatica are the least of your worries. You're basically in a whole different medical category to try to deal with the real issue, which is this tumor. So back to Luke 19, verse 8. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." My observation is that talking about sin is not terribly popular these days. And honestly, I get why. Not only is it kind of tricky to talk about, but the truth is, I think this is true. In some churches, in some contexts, sin can be over-focused on, as if the life of following Christ is merely about avoiding certain behaviors or something. I don't know, if you have had a church background, it's possible you come from a place where sin was overemphasized in some unhealthy way. It's possible what you learned about sin was manipulative or harmful even, like heaping shame upon shame without any mention of the grace of God. And no, that is not a helpful way to talk about sin. But if I can risk kind of a generalization, my sense is that for the most part, in our current world, our tendency in the church has been to swing the other direction, to minimize, to not talk about it much, to hope that with, if I can mix a metaphor, with some rest, some light stretching maybe, the symptoms of this thing called sin will kind of go away eventually. But I'm not so sure that that's a healthy way to go about it either. In the practice of medicine, remember, an effective treatment requires an accurate diagnosis. What would it look like to accurately diagnose something like sin? Let's talk about sin for a moment. What is sin? How do we understand sin? The thing about sin is that if we talk about it merely as a list of do's and don'ts, we are already in trouble. It seems to me that to understand what we're talking about when we talk about sin, we need to start with like our understanding of the world and the Christian kind of story of the world. So let's start there. So ready? This is going to be like Genesis to now in like 8 seconds. But this is important, seriously. God created the cosmos and created it good. Right relationships existed between humans and each other, between humans and God, and humans and the rest of creation. However, through deception, their own choices, out of the desire to define their relationship with God on their own terms, the first humans participated in sin, essentially a severing of that right relationship with God, the world, and each other. We saw God's way and we thought we knew better. One way to think about the overarching story of the Bible, by the way, is to think of it as God's initiatives over time to create anew that severed relationship through the family of Abraham and Sarah and the Israelites and on and on and on. Well, eventually, there's a fairly radical claim in Scripture that redemption comes through a person, through Jesus, the Messiah, fully God and fully human. He entered into human frailty. He was rejected by the very people he created, and he died a horrible death on a cross. But he did not stay dead. He overcame death, anticipating the end of all things when we believe the world will be redeemed according to God's justice and mercy. So here and now, where God's rule and reign is both here, but not yet fully realized, we work in a world in which we are still disposed in some ways to selfishness, to living as other than in right relationships. So sin is multidimensional. Sin refers to the things we do that are other than what God has called us to do. But sin is also a way in which we're formed. It's a state that we find ourselves in fractured and severed relationships. So what is sin? Sin is separation. Sin is alienation. The opposite of sin is wholeness, shalom, of being in good and right relationships with God, with others, with ourselves, with the world. And the mediator, this is really important, the mediator of those right relationships, of salvation, you might call it, is not human cleverness, or keeping a list of do's and don'ts, or rationalizing it away, or especially ignoring the problem. Instead, true right relationship only comes through the forgiveness and grace made possible through Christ, whose life, death, and resurrection redeems us. I will confess that I went through a period of bitterness with my original doctors, the ones who diagnosed me with run-of-the-mill sciatica without taking a closer look. They minimized and ignored deeper causes of my pain for a long time, despite me saying, I'm not so sure if this is what it is. It's hard to know what difference it would have made if they had taken a deeper look sooner. It might have made a difference, I don't know. But the truth is, I can't blame them. Minimizing is kind of part of the human condition, isn't it? Left to my own devices, I'm tempted to do the same thing with sin all the time. No amount of stretching, rest, or pain medication would take away a tumor. It's not that kind of thing. But imagine if once I found out that a tumor was responsible for my pain, I just like continued with that same ineffective treatment. I wonder if we sometimes do the same thing with sin in our lives. In reality, is sin more like run-of-the-mill sciatica that will go away on its own, no big deal? Or is it more like a tumor that, if left unchecked, is literally fatal? I wonder about you. If you're honest with yourself, do you notice patterns in your life that are not good for you? And more than that, maybe patterns in your life that contribute to that separation from God, from others. If you're honest with yourself, are there any parts of your life where repentance and new life are needed? Is there any part of you that's tempted to say, well, hopefully it'll clear up in a few days to minimize? I wonder if Zacchaeus was tempted to minimize his own sin. Like, how easy would it have been for Zacchaeus to host Jesus for a meal even and show off his great wealth and kind of harden his heart a little bit? You know, I deserve this money. These people don't like me anyway. I don't owe them anything. And Jesus would have been on his way. And in doing so, Zacchaeus would have maintained the status quo. He wouldn't have had to give away any of his stuff. And he would have missed out on maybe the most beautiful words you could hear from Jesus. Today, salvation has come to this house. Zacchaeus came to understand his way of life was leading to his death. He knew he didn't have run-of-the-mill sciatica. He had a life-threatening tumor. As an unethical tax collector, he was participating in broader systems of sin, of alienating people from each other, and he was getting rich off of it. He was exploiting people. He was part of a system that was exploiting people. And he was benefiting financially even as it killed his soul. What did it take? Somehow he realized it was no longer worth it. I speculate, if that's okay to do, that he was tired of living with the tumor. The way of Jesus seemed so much better than that old dead life. Why not take a risk? So he confessed that sin that he was participating in. He made plans to conduct his life in a more just way, a way that promoted healing and reconciliation. He began to behave in a way that restored relationships rather than tore them down. And right then and there, he began to experience the grace of Jesus for him. Today, salvation has come to this house. I think this morning's message is that today, no matter how bad things feel like they are for you, salvation can come to your house. So I want to invite you to take a moment and close your eyes if you would like, if you're comfortable doing so. And I want to invite you to reflect on a couple of things here in some silence. In a few moments, I'm going to invite us into a time of actually corporate confession, which is done every week in some liturgical churches. The idea is we're always in the need of the grace of God. But right now, in the quiet of your own heart, let's take a few minutes to pray and reflect in silence, and maybe guided by a couple questions I'll throw out to you. So in honest prayer, I want to encourage you to invite the Holy Spirit right now to search your heart. Maybe your prayer sounds something like this: God, is there anything in me that is keeping me from you? God, is there anything in me that is keeping me from you? We believe the Holy Spirit is active. If you sense an area or areas of your life coming to mind, I have to believe that's not by accident or coincidence. It's probably something worth paying attention to. So still in silence, maybe your next prayer is simply, God, help me to own up to those things that are causing separation, to turn away from them, to receive your grace for a new life. I would encourage you, if in these moments the Holy Spirit's bringing things up to your mind, don't ignore them or rush quickly beyond them. Why? There is no shame, zero shame, in acknowledging the seriousness of the situation. But once you're aware of it, yeah, why ignore it? A grace-filled redemption is possible for you, for me, for all of us. In many liturgical churches, the idea of confession and communion kind of go together. Communion being a tangible way in which we receive God's grace through participating in the body and blood of Christ. But before doing so, to confess corporately that we are prone to wander and need of grace. So I'd like to invite you to participate in a moment in a kind of a corporate prayer of confession. It'll be on the screens, and what I want to do is actually read this through once, and you can just kind of take it in. And in a moment, I will invite you, if you are in a place where you would like to participate in this confession, to say it out loud with me. So here's what it sounds like. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. I just want to say this real quick. God knows your heart. And so even words like that can sometimes be a, I believe that I want to believe this. I think the power of Almighty God can work with that. I want to invite you to confess this together as a corporate confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. So a confession has a counterpart, which is called an assurance of pardon. And that means that even if it feels like in some ways, I'm not sure exactly what these words are going to mean, here is the gift of grace that is for you regardless. That if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So on the basis of God's words, you need to know that you are forgiven. As Christ forgives us, so may we also forgive others. We've talked about this in past liturgical chapels or depending on the church you go to, but the celebration at the table of communion really is kind of the pinnacle of worship. It's not a song, it's not a sermon. It is grace. It is the body and blood of Christ shed and broken for us that we can participate in, so that we can be the body and blood of Christ for the world around us, redeemed by his blood. What we do here at APU is called an open table, and that means that if you are somebody who right now in this room, whether you've been following Jesus a long time, whether you stumbled in here and you're like, I didn't know that this is a chapel, great. Whether you have committed to following Christ or whether you feel far from him, if there is something in you that feels stirred to receive the grace of Jesus Christ in a new way, this is for you. And God's grace is for you today. So I'd like to just encourage kind of a spirit of reverence during this time. I know end of October, Friday, all that kind of stuff. I'm sure you got something, some costume to dress up in this weekend or something. All of that kind of stuff is true. But here we are right now. Don't rush through this time. As I kind of lead us through meditating on and receiving God's grace for us. So would you join me in this prayer as I prayed over us. Holy and gracious God, in your infinite love, you have made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, and to reconcile us to you, the God and Creator of all. So on the night that he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we are invited to proclaim together, and it's on your screens, the mystery of the faith. Let's proclaim this together, that Christ has died, that Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Amen. I'd like to invite the band to come back up and take these few moments seriously. Why not? And what I'm hoping is that even after this chapel time, there will be some space for you. I wonder if God has started something in your heart today or continued something that has been happening for a little while. I want to invite you, minimizing it is not going to work, so don't do it. Don't do it. Take it seriously. Why not? All you have to gain is everything. All you have to lose is stuff that was never yours anyway. So come to the sacred table, not because you must, but because you may. Come to testify not that you are righteous, but that you sincerely love our Lord Jesus Christ and desire to be his true disciples. Come not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Not because you have any claim on the grace of God, but because in your frailty and in your sin, you stand in constant need of his mercy and help. Come not to express an opinion, but to seek his presence and to pray for his Spirit. These are the gifts of God for us, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. You're invited now to come forward, to take communion back to your chair, to sing along, to pray. Let's continue in this atmosphere of worship and reflection together. Amen. Let's stand together if you're willing and able for a closing blessing and benediction. And I think the blessing is this. If God's doing something in your life, at the risk of repeating myself, don't ignore it. Whether that started today or you're like, okay, God, this is like multiple things, and like, I think that's probably something. So the blessing is that God's grace is for you in the midst of your process. This is not a shaming God who wants to drag you into something, but a warm parent who wants to invite you into grace and love and mercy. Lord, would you be with these students? Would you be with this community? God, do something in us that can only come through repentance. It can only come through naming wrong, naming evil, and allowing you to do what you need to do. God, would this be a new day for some in this room? Lord, would you be at work? Would we be open to seeing how you are at work? We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You're free to go. Have a great Friday.